Okay, what we are talking about today is solving by square roots. So one of the methods that we can use to solve a quadratic equation is square roots. And when you do, you're going to always have a positive or a negative for your answer when you're the one taking the square root. So the trick is you want to get the square term all by itself first and then take the square root. So pretend like this is just 2x minus 15. Add the 15 to both sides. You've got 2x squared is equal to 80. Divide by 2, and you have x squared is equal to 40. Now, once you have isolated the squared term, then you can take the square root. So, the square root of x squared is x. The square root of 40, this is going to be where I have to simplify this. First of all, it's going to be a positive or a negative answer. But I have to think about this. 40 has a perfect square of 4 trapped inside. So that is 4 times 10. So I can write that as the square root of 4 times the square root of 10. Now I know the square root of 4 is 2. So it's positive or negative 2, square root of 10. So if I was typing this into Buzz, I could type in plus or minus 2 radical 10. So again, in Buzz, there's really no way to type in a plus or minus button. But you would just do plus minus 2 square root of 10, okay? All right, let's look at this next one. So now our goal is to get the x squared term alone. So I move the 11 over. So I have x squared is equal to negative 9. Now up until when we knew about imaginary numbers, you would tell me this is no real solution. And you're correct, it is no real solution. But I can take the square root of this, and I know how to take the square root of a negative now. So x is positive or negative, the square root of negative 9. So if we struggle with this, we can break it down to negative 1 times negative 9. And I can take each of those square roots separately. So it is positive or negative, square root of negative 1 is I, square root of 9 is 3. So we write this as plus or minus 3i. Okay, let's try this next one again. My goal is to get my x squared thing alone first. So now I'm going to be solving for this x minus 4. That's what I want to get, that x minus 4 squared all by itself first. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to add 1 to both sides. So I have 1/3 times x minus 4 squared is equal to 11. Now, I don't want to take a square root with this 1/3 on the side. It's not that mathematically I couldn't do that. It's that it's going to be so much easier if I just get rid of that fraction first. So get rid of that fraction by multiplying both sides by 3. Remember, this is one term because of these parentheses making it all one term. So when I multiply, that cancels. And I have x minus 4 squared is equal to 33. Now, remember, once I get the squared thing alone, I'm home free. I just take the square root of both sides. Now, square root of x minus 4 squared is just x minus 4. And this is plus or minus square root of 33. 33 doesn't have any perfect squares trapped inside. So it is just this plus or minus square root of 33. I have to add this 4 over to the other side. So my answer is 4 plus or minus the square root of 33. So in Buzz, you can literally type in 4 plus minus square root 33. That's going to be how you'll type it into Buzz because there's not a plus or a minus button. Okay, let's keep on going here. Again, I'm looking at this. I want to get my x squared all by itself. So I'm going to move this 18 over. 2x squared is going to be equal to negative 90. I'm going to divide both sides by 2, and I'm going to have x squared is equal to negative 45. Remember, once I get the x squared thing alone, I can take the square root of it. Now, I want to do the square root of x squared. It's x. I know this is going to have a negative 1. And I know there's a perfect square trapped in 45. I know that 9 is a perfect square that is trapped inside there. 45 is 9 times 5. So negative 45 is negative 1, positive 9, positive 5. And I can take the square root of each of those terms. But remember, I'm the one that took the square root, so I have to have that plus or minus. So x equals, well, plus or minus I, this is 3, and this doesn't simplify. So my answer is plus or minus 3i square root 5. I always put the square root at the end because sometimes if I'm handwriting it, I would put it at the end because if I wrote square root of 5i, you might wonder if that I is on the inside or on the outside. So just to make it easier, we always put the I in front of, or we put the square root at the very last thing. Okay, here we go again. Now, again, my goal is to get my x squared, or whatever is squared, not necessarily x. In this situation, it's x minus 4 again. Get that alone. So I have x minus 4 squared is equal to 25. Remember, once I get the squared thing alone, I take the square root. So this becomes x minus 4. Hey, I know the square root of 25. It's a perfect square, plus or minus 5. So I add 4 to get it over here, and it's x is equal to 4 plus or minus 5. Now, let's figure out these numbers are. Don't write type in 4 plus or minus 5. 4 plus 5 is the answer 9. And 4 minus 5 is negative 1. So my answers are negative 1 and 9. And that's what I'm going to type into Buzz. Okay, now we're ready for an application here. So when I'm looking at this, so if I'm dropping an object off the roof of an apartment building and it's 240 feet in the air, this is the height function. So when we've seen these before, negative 16 is the effect of gravity pulling it down. Typically, we've seen like a number in the middle with a T. That is the initial velocity, but we're not throwing it up in the air here. We are just dropping it. And then the last term is the initial height. So this is the initial height. So let's just make sure we know all of our things first. This is the initial height. And here in this problem, we call it, it is 240. And this is how high something is. So if I could think about this as a parabola, it's just getting going down like this. This is time going across, and this is the height. And it's just a piece of a parabola. The other part of it might have existed over here if I could write the whole equation. But remember, negative time doesn't exist. So this is just time going forward and the height. So the question is, how long? When it says how long, it wants to know the answer in time. And until it hits the ground. Now, I just want you to realize, what's the height of something on the ground? The height is zero at the ground, right? I mean, we could get our rulers out and try and measure it, but we're talking about the height being zero. So the first thing I have to be able to do is take this 240 feet, the initial height, and plug it into my equation. So my height function is negative 16 t squared plus 240. So now I have a complete equation. Now, the next thing I need to do is realize it's asking me, well, when does it hit the ground? Well, that means, when does this h equal zero? So now I'm just solving this equation. So I subtract 240, so negative 240 is negative 16 t squared. T squared is equal to 15. Now, in this circumstance, it is a word problem. So I don't want a simplified radical answer. I want a decimal answer because it's going to make sense. So I'm going to go to my calculator and I'm going to do the square root of 15. So t is equal to, now remember in the calculator, when you type in the square root, so you can go second, square root, and type in the 15. And then there's this button right here above the enter key, and it'll turn it into a decimal. Okay? So my answer is plus or minus 3.87 seconds. Now, let's have a conversation. Negative time doesn't exist, right? So if I'm just talking about the parabola without an application, the negative 3.87 is over here. But this thing doesn't exist until here, until time is zero. So negative time doesn't exist. We call that an extraneous solution. So if I have two answers, negative 3.87 and positive 3.87, I eliminate the extraneous one that doesn't make sense. And then I have my answer, hey, how long does it take to hit the ground? 3.87 seconds. Okay, I hope that you're in a good place for solving by square roots. So remember, when each of these, when we solved them, they had an x squared term only. They did not have a linear x. There wasn't something that was just a plain old x. So when you look at each of these, you knew you could use the square root method because it was x squared, because it was x squared, because something, the whole thing was squared, because there's just an x squared here. The whole thing is squared. So that's important as we start to determine which method you're going to use. Now, I want you to be good at solving by square roots, but eventually you're going to have all these methods and need to know which method to use when. All right. Hope this helps you.